put 15 points on the Bears.
I would like to call to order the City of Lake Forest District 67 2015-2016 budget hearing.
I believe so.
May I have a roll call vote, please, Madam Clerk?
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mrs. Clemenson?
Here.
Ms. Borkowski?
Here.
Mr. Fulker?
Here.
Mrs. Sands?
Here.
Mr. Novit?
Here.
Mr. Ford?
Here.
We have a quorum.
Thank you. Thank you for everyone for coming as well. We start tonight with a special budget hearing. After that meeting, we'll move to our regular Board of Ed meeting, and I'll turn it over to our business folks, Jen and Alan.
Sorry, you're only getting Jen today.
Even better.
All right, this is the 2016 budget hearing for Lake Forest District 67. We're going to go over some of the legal requirements of how we got to this point and the budget adoption. We're going to briefly cover the financial condition of the district and where we ended 14-15. Mr. Simic is going to cover some of our instructional highlights. We'll talk a little bit about projected revenues and expenditures for 15-16. And then at that point, I would suggest to the board that they open it up for public comment, which is the main purpose of this hearing, for any member of the public who would like to speak or on behalf of the budget piece only at this time, then you would welcome them to do so. Prior to adopting the budget, there's a few things that we need to do. We do need to place our tentative budget on display for a minimum of 30 days. We did so. The board approved the tentative budget being put on display on July 21st. We did publish a notice in the newspaper, for those of you that still read newspapers, that was printed on July 28th, that the budget was actually available for public inspection. They could come in and see it in our office, or we'd be happy to forward it to them as well. We set a date and time for a public hearing, which we did so, which is tonight. And we are required to adopt a budget by the end of our first quarter. So since our fiscal year runs July 1 through June 30th, that would be September. So we do need to adopt a budget by the end of September. A little bit difficult to see, but the financial condition of the district as of the end of last year. One of the measures that we do, and it's contained in your board packet in another format, is we look at our financial state as our budget balance as a percentage of our operating expenditures. The board actually has a policy, it's policy 4.20 for those that are interested in looking it up, which says the school district seeks to maintain year-end fund balances in the range of 10 to 15%. In the event that the percentage exceeds 15%, a report detailing the rationale for the additional funds, including the planned expenditures, timing, and other pertinent information will be provided to the board. Based on the figures that are shown, our year-end fund balance is actually 22.95%. As such, there is a fund balance report contained in the Board of Education meeting tonight, the packet, pursuant to policy 4.20. It does talk a little bit about how we got to this point as a fund balance, and it also talks about how it's anticipated that the fund balance will drop to 19% at the end of this fiscal year. And then also in future years, it talks about things that are assumed as far as our five-year projection in regards to state funding, potential cost shifts, and our capital and life safety projects. Not to steal all the thunder from Mr. Albus's report, but it does indicate that we anticipate the fund balance will be drawn down into that 10 to 15% range within a few years. I am going to turn it over to Mr. Simic on the instructional highlights.
Okay, one of the things that, one of the requests prior to this budget hearing that we heard is that a nice thing to point out is how does this connect to the mission and vision and particularly the milestones of the district. So I wanted to highlight a number of things that in this particular budget that are very connected to things that we're doing in the district. First off, the K-8 Lucy Calkins Writers Workshop Professional Development. Those of you who have been to an open house, the curriculum nights, probably every single teacher that you heard from, language arts teachers, talked about our beginning the writer's workshop. So tremendous amount of activity in this building all summer long. We also sent a team of teachers to Columbia University in Manhattan over the summer to learn about how to spent time with Lucy Calkins, who's the developer of the program, and then how to implement that on a school-wide basis. Then for the coming year, also still in this budget, but also overlapping into next year, is the Reader's Workshop. So there are materials, but there's a huge amount of professional development that goes along with that. With math, we have a new math course material adoption, very significant. It's going to affect every student in grades 6 through 8. STEM inquiry, so we put in the lab in June, and then also we have a commitment of dollars to the materials for that. The new schedule that students are going to be experiencing this year on both the east and west side. There's an increase in time for 6 through 8 core classes. Importantly, there's an addition of 3.5 FTE. What that means in layman's terms, FTE means teachers, 3.5 new teachers that were added to the schedule in order to give more flexibility, more collaborative time to the teachers. And also importantly, the flexibility is not just for the teaching staff, it's more importantly for the students that are going to be experiencing that in their instructional day. Response to intervention in special ed, we've increased our push-in support. In layman's terms, what that means is that instead of sending kids down the hall to get help, so if a student struggles with reading or with writing or what have you, a less expensive and also less effective way to provide support for those students is to aggregate them. That means put them in a group down the hall where they all get one, so one teacher sends one student, another teacher sends two students, and so on, and they meet down the hall. What happens when you do that with special ed students is that they never stay with their non-special ed peers and their instruction. So it's a more expensive model to have them come in to the classroom. The teachers come in and provide that support in the class, but then there's much, much less of a separation in achievement. Also, an increase in co-teaching is one of the things that we've talked about a lot over the course of the past couple years, is co-planning, co-teaching, and co-serving students. One of the things that we see in education, and any of us that have been through a typical public school education experience know that public school teaching historically has been one of the most isolated professions of all professions in the world. And so that co-teaching, it's challenging because you're co-planning and then co-serving, but it's also really, really stimulating. And then a focus on data analysis. We have people in each building that are going to be working with the teachers in the building, focusing on slicing and dicing our data to get a better picture of what students are, how they are performing. Facility highlights. There are a couple really significant things. These are very immediate as well that you may have seen. If you've walked in to either Sheridan or Cherokee, you immediately notice that the carpet is gone, as is the smell. The old carpet trapped a fair number of odors. We're really happy that that is gone. Also, all new paint and a lot of other cosmetic work that was done there, floor tile throughout. In this current year, one of the major things we're going to be doing is looking at almost $700,000 of infrastructure and life safety and maintenance. I'm pleased to see Rick Schuler here, who is chair of the Finance Committee, when a lot of these things were discussed and we're executing our first year of that. So with that, hand off to Mrs. Hermes.
Let's wait to see if he was just going to finish. This is the budget summary. This is a very high level look. Just to note, we did go through the budget in further detail at the August 6th Finance and Operations Committee. I'm not sure if that's covered in the report tonight or not. We are not showing any changes in revenues at this point, largely because there still has been no action out of Springfield. So the question marks that we had in April, May, June, July are still question marks. As a reminder, though, we did conservatively put into this budget not receiving all of our state payments. We typically would receive and expect to receive 4 payments, categorical payments. We only put in that we expect to receive 3 of those. We think something is going to come down the pipe, whether or not it's going to be exactly as we've outlined or something a little bit different. We do expect to receive less from the state in some way, shape, or form. We also did include, and we've been talking about this for a few years, is an assumption that we are going to assume 0.5% of a pension cost shift. Now, whether that will occur or it will be a further proration in revenues or will there be something totally new, we don't know at this point. But conservatively, since our budget is due to be approved and adopted and yet theirs is still the big blank, we need to have something in as a baseline. We have no changes presented from the tentative budget and expenditures as well. We do monitor staffing fairly tightly at this time of year. We are ticked up a little bit in special education. That's based on specific student needs. However, at this point, we don't think that it's enough that it would warrant an actual adjustment. There are many things in the budget that will kind of go up and down, especially at the beginning time of the year. So if we feel that that's a significant change, we'll bring that back to the board and we could amend at a later point. At this point, we don't feel the need necessarily. The only change that I will make note to the board, no changes, like I said, revenues to expenses. However, I did notate on the front of your state form, which is the really pretty form in the packet that just looks like this, if anybody's interested in it. We did update. At the time that we put the tentative budget on display in July, we had not yet fully closed our books from June 30th. So we have updated the final year-end balances. So if you looked at the state form, that would be the only change that you would actually notice. Just in summary, we are showing this is a budget where the expenditures exceed revenues by almost $1.3 million. This is not unanticipated. This is as we've been laying out the plan. And we said earlier that fund balance policy will indicate and the report will follow that we do anticipate this to occur for the next few years. I would caution you, though, not to assume necessarily that this is a structural deficit. This is planned and anticipated. Many of these are capital projects. We did not do many capital projects for many years. We deferred some maintenance intentionally during some of the economic downturn, but it's time that we need to start reinvesting in our facilities. So that's what you're seeing intentionally over the next few years. At this point, it does conclude our presentation of the budget hearing, and I would suggest that you open up to the public for comment.
Before we move to the public, is there any questions or comments from board members?
I will say the board does have it on its agenda later tonight as well, so you do have another opportunity.
Are there any members of the public that would want to comment on our budget? Seeing none, thank you very much. I believe that concludes our budget hearing. Can I have a motion to adjourn from our budget hearing?
So moved.
Is there a second? Thank you. I believe we can do a voice vote to adjourn. All those in favor of adjourning?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? We are adjourned from our budget hearing. I'd like to call to order the City of Lake Forest District 67 Board of Education meeting for September 21st, 2015. May I have a roll call vote, please, Madam Clerk?
Mr. Novit?
Here.
Mr. Ford?
Here.
Mrs. Clemenson?
Here.
Mr. Folker?
Here.
Dr. Lemke?
Here.
Mrs. Sands?
Here.
Mr. Borkowski?
Here.
We have a quorum.
Thank you. Cornelius, can you bring that up now, please? Thank you. There's been a lot of talk in the community lately about our school district. Most of the comments that I've heard revolved around two questions. Where's our school district headed? And what does the new teacher contract mean for District 67? The president's report tonight, I'd like to touch on both of those questions. First, where is District 67 headed? What is the grand plan? What is our vision? As many of you know, last year, we spent a lot of effort defining and approving a district vision and mission statement, which eloquently and accurately describes exactly where our district is headed. I don't plan to review that document again in detail tonight. Rather, I want to simply share some words that are frequently used by the board, the administration, and the staff on a daily basis. These words give a good reflection of the district's vision. Then, by providing some concrete examples of how these words come to life in our schools, hopefully a clearer picture of where we are headed will start to emerge. So what are some of these words? Every student, this is probably the dominant theme of District 67 right now. It doesn't say most children, not the majority, not 99%, not the lowest common denominator, but every student, an individualized learning plan for every single student. Student engagement, that would be in contrast to traditional lectures that most of us grew up with. Student growth, that's in contrast to success equaling test scores, more traditional way of looking at things. Differentiation in the classroom, inquiry-based learning, collaborative learning, with Mike Semek recently, a few minutes ago, talked about the push-in model that goes to all those words. Student choice, supporting passions. Talent, we talk constantly about attracting, retaining, and developing great talent. Reimagine learning spaces, social, emotional, and academic health, and communication. There's also a couple of questions that our board asks pretty much every time we make an important decision, and these questions also impact where we're headed. Two of those main questions are, does the decision we're making accelerate us towards the vision, and is it good for the kids? There's also a few questions additional to those that we ask. Are we being fiscally responsible, and how does the decision impact the staff? So what does all that mean, all those words and all those questions? A lot of educator speak phrases, and what does that look like in real life? Again, rather than provide long, wordy explanations, I just want to give actual examples of things being introduced in our school buildings. And hopefully combining these questions, comments, and examples will start to paint a picture of where we're headed. ELO. ELO is a new block of time at Deer Path for our fifth through eighth graders. Students choose from a menu of non-traditional topics for seven-week sessions. This is all about students pursuing their passions. They're fully engaged, it's hands-on, typically project-based environment, and typically taught by staff members who are also passionate about it. So some of the examples you see up there, there's knitting class, there's band, there's drums, there's guitar. The lower left is actually a coding class, and the lower right is one of my favorites for fifth through eighth graders who want to study sports statistics and analysis. There's a ELO class on that. Another example is the Cube. It's not your parents' library. It's really the epitome of a reimagined workspace. It supports flexibility, creativity, collaboration, technology. You see here a green room where students, fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth graders, are making their own movies and videos. And if you look hard, there are even a few hard-covered books in there as well. The STEM labs, we've got a fifth and sixth grade STEM lab, seventh and eighth grade STEM lab. These are really more than high-tech science labs. They're really the poster child for student engagement. The teacher truly has become a coach and a facilitator. The teacher typically has to get out of the way as the students come into the class, because the students come in and get to work without really the teacher even giving them any instruction. Personally, I struggled to believe that when I heard that, and I took a field trip last year and saw one of the STEM labs in action, and that really is true how it works. STEM Lab supports all of those things: student engagement, student choice, as the students choose different projects to work on, reimagined workspaces. This room didn't used to be a science lab, it used to be a largely unused room off of the side of the library. Differentiated learning. Every student goes to the STEM Lab, and whether you're a high achieving student or a student who needs more support, you pick a project that's right for you, that challenges you and pushes you. So all those words really come alive in that example. So far I focused on DPM, there's many more examples. At Cherokee, the Inspiration Block, which is a fancy name for a cool project-based learning where everything is hands-on. The kids generally have so much fun they don't know that they're in school. Last year the fourth graders ended up presenting one of their projects to the City of Lake Forest Alternative Energy Forum, really showing how the classroom gets extended into the community. Sheridan has a light bulb lab and an Empower Hour, which is somewhat similar to Everett, where they have an innovation lab, a makerspace, and coding classes. In all of those examples, it's more engagement, more choice, more passion, more hands-on, creativity is flowing, mistakes are being made, risks are happening, and frankly, inventors are being born. The push-in model, which Mike talked about a few minutes ago, this model is generally misunderstood by most of our community. What this model is all about is meeting every single student at his or her level. whether that's super advanced or in need of a lot of support or somewhere in between. It's challenging every student appropriately, and the data actually shows it's a much better model for every student on the spectrum. The new curriculum that was mentioned in the budget hearing, at times it can seem, how is curriculum choice driving our vision? Both of these two curriculum, which is in writing and math, they're significantly more engaging, they're significantly more hands-on, it's collaborative learning, and both of them are a significantly more effective way for our students to learn. When we did the vision and mission project, one of the parent surveys showed that parents listed social-emotional well-being and balance as one of their top priorities. And we see this in terms of the example with the fact that we have 4 full-time school psychologists and an emotional wellness coordinator. The expanded human resources that we actually hire and put in place demonstrates the commitment. And we haven't mentioned finances as part of this presentation, but the district is committed to moving quickly towards district vision, but we'll do it in a fiscally responsible way. Not only do we have a strong financial position, but we're one of very few school districts that has a AAA bond rating and a healthy reserve. Fiscal health ultimately is good for taxpayers and for our students. I purposely saved one of the most important examples towards the end of this, and that's the teachers' new contract. We recently approved a 5-year teacher contract. We constantly are talking about attracting, retaining, and developing talent, literally almost every meeting that we have. And this new contract is one of the most significant examples of the district walking the talk as we strive to achieve the talent portion of our vision and mission. Before talking about any of the details, both financial and non-financial, I want to thank a number of people who are listed on this sheet. The negotiations started in January of this year, and some of the prep work actually started before that. All of these folks spent tens and tens and tens of hours for the good of the district. On the left-hand side is the team of folks from the Lake Forest Educational Association, Ben Gray, Sue Christensen, who is hiding in the back of this room, Susie, Paul, Carolyn, Jean, and Ann, and from the administration and the board, Jen Hermes, Lori Wilcox, Ingrid Weimer, Rob and Jeff from the board, Mike Hernandez, our counsel, and Bill Anderson and Rick Schuler from our prior board who kicked this off. And Rick is hiding on the opposite end of the room over there. So thank each of you on behalf of the schools, the community, and the students. Thank you all for the amount of time and effort you put in making this happen. Regarding the financials, the projected aggregate salary increases during the 5-year contract, which have been reported for the 5 years, are 5.5%, 5.2%, 3.7, 3.6, and 3.7. You don't need to memorize those, but I had a friend ask me last week, he said, Mike, those percentages seem pretty rich. Are we the highest paying school district in the area? And I think it's a great question and one that needs to be answered. We compare ourselves to 17 peer districts, mostly North Shore districts in the surrounding vicinity that have similar characteristics to Lake Forest. So there's a whole bunch of different data points and I won't take you through all of them, but for starting salaries, that's a new teacher at the bottom of the salary schedule. District 67 currently ranks number 13 out of those 17. By the end of this contract, we project to move to about number 8 out of 17. In aggregate, if you look at the majority of the data points, for most of them, we are currently around number 13 or 14 out of 17, and we project to move around number 8 or 9, depending on the data point. So we're moving from a bit below average currently towards the median of the peer group by the end of the contract. At a basic level, the contract is helping us be more competitive in the marketplace, but by no means are we setting the bar for the highest salaries on the North Shore. Competitive and fair are appropriate words in my mind. So from a financial perspective, the contract allows us to attract and retain our existing talent, which is definitely a key component of the mission and vision. Perhaps more exciting are some of the non-financial components of the contract. First, our students are guaranteed 5 years of labor peace, and this shouldn't be overlooked as it allows everyone, teachers, administration, students, parents, everyone involved, to be focused on achieving the mission and vision and not on salary schedules, complex legalese, or negotiating strategies. There's 2 other non-financial points that I want to highlight in the contract. Significant improvements were made in the area of professional development. Many of our teachers, frankly, most of our teachers, want to continue their own education and develop new skills, and the board wants to support those efforts as well. Through this contract, we've increased the financial support for teachers to take courses, and at the same time, we've also included a process to ensure that the courses taken are meaningful and high quality. An additional day of professional development is also included in the contract. The contract also provides additional hiring flexibility. In certain situations, the district may wish to hire an experienced superstar teacher. Through a number of contract changes and flexible negotiations between the teacher association and the administration and board, the district now has more flexibility than previously to successfully attract this talent. My final example of where we're headed as a district sums up everything I've discussed in one visual. When most of us went to school, this is how we learned. If we wanted to learn about a robot, we'd have a science book, we'd have a notebook, we'd read our book, we'd take notes, and we would likely forget about them in a week or two. We don't learn that way anymore. Now we actually learn with robots. The students actually build the robots. They've learned how to program them. They're engaged, it's hands-on, they're collaborating. They're making mistakes, they're screwing up, they're figuring it out. Every student is challenged according to his or her own abilities. Some are doing much more advanced programs, some are doing much simpler programs. They're excited and they actually learn better and the knowledge is retained. And sometimes it even works for me, so that's good. So fortunately, while I can describe where we're headed, I'm not the one who actually implements all this stuff. I'm not the person literally tasked with transforming it, nor are my fellow board members. We're all better off with that. The person charged with overseeing that is our superintendent, Mike Semek. The way he and his team go about the transformation in a structured way is through the strategic plan. With that, I'll conclude a lengthy president's report and we'll shift to the superintendent report where we'll learn a little bit more about the strategic plan. Mike?
A brief and hopefully very engaging book on the history and development of the American educational system by two of the most respected and well-known researchers on education history. And it's a look back where you can see how some of the things that we're doing, how they differ from things that have been done historically in the history of education in this country. Very informative. I hope you enjoy it as much as some of us did when we read it. It's the standard work for education programs. You're going to go get a PhD in education. This is likely going to be one of the required readings. So what I wanted to do is start out with to piggyback on to what Mr. Borkowski was sharing with us. That is the notion of how important our teaching staff is. One of the things that we hear and we say very frequently is our district is never any better than our teachers. And want to introduce you to a number of new folks that we have. I'd like to thank Laura Montgomery for putting this together for us. So as you can see, that's really, that's a lot of new teachers. And so I'd like to say thanks to Dr. Wilcox, who leads human resources. A lot of emphasis over the past year on developing hiring practices, procedures for the district that were then applied and implemented. One of the changes that was made in the course of a couple years ago to this current school year is the development of having teachers teach sample lessons, so bringing in students and then having them teach with administrators observing. And you learn a lot. It's a very, very different environment than having somebody sit down and talk to a group of adults. When they watch them interact with students, that's where the rubber meets the road. And that was a significant thing that I think all of our administrators really appreciated, something brand new in this course of hiring. So also very thankful for the board for committing the money for professional development. And if this were, if a farm analogy would be professional development is like the seed, and you plant and then you watch that grow. And then one of the things that that good farmers do is they commit to the care and feeding of the plants. And so that's very much what an organization is like. The teachers are the most important thing in the entire district. The whole district exists for one purpose, and really one purpose only, and that is the student-teacher relationship. That's everything. And so we can have all the best plans from this office or any other office in the district, but that that doesn't do us a whole lot of good if we don't have really good teachers who are strongly supported. So I want to go through with a number of things on the strategic plan. Some of this will be not a repeat, but another look at some of the things that Mr. Borkowski talked about. So there's a summary. First off, this is from Dr. Steve Cordigan, who did some of our research this past year on our student achievement. A couple key takeaways. Our students are typically two full grade levels above the national norm. And you can see this on our MAP tests. And these are districts that use MAP, and most of the districts that use MAP tend to be districts of somewhat greater means. And so even compared to those districts, our typical student is a full 2 years ahead in both reading and in math. They also, very importantly, continue to grow. So they don't just start out ahead, they stay ahead, and they grow more than the national norm as well. The ACT, I mentioned that because 75% of the instruction that takes place on the 11th graders taking the ACT is actually from this school district in grades K through 8. It's the highest ACT ever in the history of Lake Forest High School. It's an average score of 27. Some of the core values Mr. Borkowski mentioned. The very first core value, the very first word, is every child, and that punctuates a lot of the things that we do. And districts tend to be good at teaching most kids or many kids, but it's really a struggle, even for a district with the kind of resources that we have, to teach every kid, to challenge every student, to use the word that Mr. Borkowski used, the growth of every student, no matter where they are, whether they're a struggling learner as somebody that is at the lower end of the achievement spectrum, or a struggling learner at the highest end of the learning spectrum for us. So reaching everybody and then challenging everybody, that's a very key concept for us. This is a brief review of our milestones. We put them together, achievement, instruction, and assessment, put them all together for the sake of simplicity and clarity. And I severely abbreviated our strategic initiatives, and I'll talk around them. The first one is a guaranteed and viable curriculum, and it's really not terribly exciting to talk about that, but it's very much like the foundation of a house. Is the curriculum a guarantee? Does every kid get a quality curriculum? Or do some kids get it? Do many kids get it? Do most get it? But every student gets it. That means that it is a guarantee that teacher A in this classroom and teacher B in that classroom have the same materials, and they're teaching the same things with similar expectations. And also that it is viable, that this is a a quality curriculum. Not only is it guaranteed, but it is a high quality curriculum for every single student. Professional development, we've talked about already. One of the things that came out in our surveys on our mission and vision work, loud and clear from the community, from the staff, and in both the high school and the elementary districts, were it's great to have high achieving kids, and we really want high achieving kids, but don't forget about the social and emotional side, that having happy, healthy, and productive kids in the long run is actually more important to us in many, many, many ways than having a student that scores well on NWEA. And so the social and emotional learning, we did a benchmark on that. We surveyed the daylights out of our parents. Thank you for participating last year. And we'll do that every 2 years for our staff and our students. We're going to be looking for two things in the coming years. The surveys that we did underline a couple things that we can focus on. One of those is on social and civic learning. And the most compelling person that we talked to in the course of this, people actually, were a group of kids at Croya that came in and volunteered their time. And we went over our strategic plan with them, and we talked about different initiatives that we had. And one of those was, how do we measure social and emotional well-being in our schools? And one of the students said, look, we're in a safe school. We're not afraid of something horrible happening like we see in other places. What for us, what safety looks like more than anything else, is one of our eighth graders said this. What safety looks like for us is emotional safety. That means that we can say things that are not popular, are not normal, in our classroom, at the lunch table, and it's the snickering and the tee-heeing that goes on. That's what we're afraid of, that we say or we are something that is not quote-unquote normal. And how are we received then? Because that's something that we don't feel as good about as we would like to. So that's something that we're going to be implementing a program called Foundations for all staff, K-8, and we're going to monitor that it's called social and civic learning. So what it really is how safe do I feel socially and emotionally in my school building? The other thing that we're going to be looking at is leadership. What leadership means, the level of leadership attributes that our staff, our students, and our families expect from us. We're going to be looking at that, and we've got some programs that we're going to be developing there as well. We mentioned the reading and writing workshop. This is a really big deal because this affects every single student right now, already this year. And if you're a parent in the district, your student has probably come home already. You've heard of curriculum nights. But this is every kid in their language arts classroom. This year it's writing workshop, and next year it's reading. Why is this important? It's important because it is differentiated instruction where kids write about things they care about. It is engaging them, bringing ideas that are important to them, and then creating draft after draft after draft that improves their skill in expressing themselves in a variety of different ways, whether it be telling a story, a narrative, a personal narrative, all sorts of different types of writing they will do. We're also going to, let me back up a little bit more. On the reading, the same thing is true with reading workshop, that kids read things that are special to them, that all of the reading isn't done like we did with a Basil reader. I don't know if anybody remembers See Dick Run and See Jane Run and so on. Those are known as Basils, where everybody gets the same time at the same place. Doesn't matter if you came into kindergarten reading like a house on fire, you're going to get Dick and Jane all the way through. With reading workshop, what you get is very differentiated instruction, meaning I'm really interested in fiction. I'm really interested in nonfiction. And if you have raised a boy, one of the things that is very common for our boys is that they are crazy interested in nonfiction reading. They want to read about natural disasters. They want to read about tornadoes and earthquakes. For many of our girls, the reading focuses on other types of nonfiction, but that nonfiction reading is just as important maybe more important than fiction reading. And historically, what we got when we went to school, it was just fiction all the way through. So reaching kids where their interests lie and then expanding on those. Our inquiry-based units of instruction, that looks like student voice and student choice. What's that mean? Kids driving their own learning. One of the most challenging things for our staff, and one of the reasons we need to hire really smart people and really hard-working people, it's a brutal shift to change from cells and bells and rows with all of the attention focused on the front of the classroom and one person speaking to, if you go into one of our classrooms now, which you're going to see, and it's a really difficult change, and I really give our teachers a lot of credit for doing it. You'll go in and you'll see kids in the hall, you'll see kids on the floor, you see kids in a group of chairs. They are all over the place. And the adult is no longer 100% of the time the focus of the classroom. One of the things with learning is that it's a key word in learning is processing. If you don't have time to process, you don't learn. And one of the really difficult things for the change of the teaching profession is that the kids don't learn when the adult is talking. Kids learn when they talk, when they process, when they work in a group, when they work on things that they care about. Inquiry, what am I interested in learning about? How do I explore that more? And we have many examples of that in the district. They use one from Cherokee this past year when they brought in the city. We have 1 in 5 trees in the community that is dying or is already dead in the form of our ash trees. Kids wanted to learn about teamwork. They also wanted to learn about why all these trees were dying, because most kids have an ash tree in their property. And so they brought in somebody from the city. They watched them cut down the tree. Of course, this is way cool because they brought all the machines with them. And there's no communication that the team of people cutting the tree down could utilize except for visual, because they couldn't hear each other because the machines are too loud. The students took notes. What did I see? What did I learn? Why was that interesting? What's different than I expected, and so on. Then they got a chance to debrief with the team that did this. And they talked about, well, why is teamwork important? Well, safety is the most important thing. Well, why is safety important? See that huge thing that we put the tree into? That's a very, very dangerous tool that we use, and people can get caught in that. People can get really hurt, so teamwork is a very important part. They also Skyped with a general at the Pentagon. All these things are things that students generated, ideas that they wanted to pursue. Then they remember them better, they're more curious about them. They want to spend time outside of class. The way that I think about this is, these are the things as a parent that your kid comes home and talks about at the dinner table. We want to own the dinner conversation all the time, all the way through. Common assessments, another thing, just like a guaranteed and viable curriculum, not terribly exciting sounding, but a common assessment means that teacher A and teacher B have a shared expectation for what kids should know and be able to do. And then at some point, they give them an assessment, also known as a test. And that test can be paper and pencil. It can be acting it out. It can be physical. It can be a whole wide range of ways that they can demonstrate their learning. But the expectation is the same. And then the really important part of the learning that takes place with a common assessment, first it's the writing it. What do we want kids to know and be able to do? How do we want to allow them to demonstrate their learning? So that stretches your brain right there. And then finally, your kids can really divide fractions, and my can't. Your kids can really write a personal narrative, and mine do that about half as well. What did you do? And now we have a chance to break down the isolation of the profession and talk about, okay, so this other thing, ratios, my kids have that down, yours don't so much, so let's compare. How did you present that? What did you do? This is a rich and a meaningful conversation. Why? Because it drives professional learning, which then drives student achievement. That's why we're here. A relationship and achievement. Other things, we want to document formative and summative assessment. Just like a guaranteed and viable curriculum and just like common assessments, we want to document what do we use for assessments. What kind of tests do we use? A summative assessment, this one is something we're all very familiar with, and that is a final exam. You took a final exam at the end of the year. What was that? At the end of the year, what did you want kids to know and be able to do? Okay? This one, much, much more unfamiliar. A formative assessment, think of it as giving the final exam on the first day of class. And if you were a student and I gave you the final exam on day one, you would take it and then you would do however well you did. Where would you be most interested? Which answers would you be most interested in seeing? The ones you got right or the ones you got wrong? For most of us, the answer is the ones I got wrong. And what that says on day one, and there's no grade attached to this, by the way. It's just, let me see what you know and can be able to do right now. So on day one, as the learner, I know, this is the list of stuff I need to learn this year. That's cool. Now I know what to focus on. And then for the teacher, what do you do if you have a student that comes in and knows 40% of what you just taught? Equivalent to knowing how to read in kindergarten and going through the Basil Reader with Dick and Jane. So what do you do with a student that knows a large portion of what you're going to teach? How do you differentiate for that student? How do you stretch that student? How does that student grow in their time with us? These are really challenging things. Another really challenging thing is to take our student growth and put that into teacher evaluations. And this is Dr. Wilcox's one of her jobs. He had teachers out and working on this 5 entire days last year. It sounds really easy, but when a teacher evaluation is connected to it, and when your job as a teacher is connected to the quality of that data, it becomes really, really, really important to you as an educator. So how do we put those in? This is part of a state law as well, something we need to figure out by 2016. At the end of the achievement stuff, I want to talk about some of the outputs of some of this. And this is from the high school. It's a little bit of an eye chart. What you can see here is in 2012, we had 930 students that took an AP test at the high school. And this coming year, we're going to have 1,441. So this is evidence of a change in expectation and rigor for students across both districts. We want to see more students taking more rigorous coursework related to growth, related to challenge. It's not that every student has to take an AP test, but we think that many, many more students can. This is one of our data points from that. For our talent, we are going to provide professional development, refine our mentoring program. We're going to develop a strong partnerships with universities. We've already gotten a number of those. We just got another connection just the other day from somebody that one of us knows saying, you know what, I just read the strategic plan that's on the website. First, I talked to the person, said, this is what you do like for fun, is to read the strategic plan. Oh yeah, it was awesome. You can find it on the website. You can search, put in the search box, strategic plan. You can read all the stuff we did last year. So the person said, look, I happen to be in a teacher training program at one of the major universities in our state. I want to talk to you guys about that. So immediately connected that person with Dr. Wilcox. So it's another good connection. Another benefit from putting things on the web for us as well. Providing adults time to collaborate and co-plan for the reasons we talked about earlier. Communication and a partnership for Milestone 5. Receive and communicate feedback on our mission, vision, milestone. This is part of that. And doing that in a large number of venues, talking about what it is, where it is that we're headed, and why. Using electronic and social media to extend to as many stakeholders as possible. And also, at the end of this year, I expect a large-scale review, pulling different groups of people in to review what have we done, where do we go from here. In environment, there's a lot going on in environment. One of those is a Learning Spaces Committee, which will have a recommendation. We think of, you think of the cube over at Deer Path. How do we have the every learning space be a teaching space like that, because that does stuff for our students that some of our current spaces do not. Obviously, integrating technology that supports a district. Amy Lamberti is some of that. She's in the back. She's one of the people that works with our staff, integrating, hey, I've got this idea. How do I use this? What do I do? And identifying opportunities that extend learning beyond the classroom walls, like going to open lands, like going, bringing people into our classrooms, like Skyping. There's a whole wide range. How do we use our community as part of our classroom? Our life safety improvements, almost $750,000 this year alone as phase one of that. And as Mr. Borkowski mentioned, implementing ELO at Deer Path East and West. This is time where kids explore things they're interested in. Very importantly, it's one of the things that Gallup poll shows year after year after year. One of the key elements for kids that are successful in school and thrive in school is one of the data points that they use, and that is the kid has a meaningful connection to at least one adult, really knows somebody well, knows them, and cares about them. And these kinds of things are areas where, you know, I always wanted to build a rocket, never thought I'd get a chance to. I don't have room for that in my day. I never had. Or I always went wanted to learn how to knit. My grandma knitted, and I wanted to do that. And that time together is very important for a lot of kids. So we are educating without boundaries. These are words that really mean something to us and to our staff, which is very important. And then learning without limits, that there's nowhere that we can't go. So that is a summary of what we're working on in a strategic plan. There's one other thing that I wanted to mention apart from that. Let me change screens here. One of the questions that I have gotten a number of times is, what is, I know a lot of what you talk about push-in support, and you talk about a lot of things that sound good for kids that are somewhere other than where my kid is on the achievement spectrum. I got a high flyer of a kid, and what are you going to do for my student? So I wanted to look at math and talk about what we're doing very specifically related to that. So over on the left, over here, you have, I'm going to come around here. So our typical student is 2 years ahead in math already relative to their national peers. But what you see here, this is a chart, it's a chart that starts in third grade, and this is one of the things that's available on the web. And what you see, if a student, we have students that are in math six in sixth grade. So that means that in sixth grade, they are doing sixth grade math. That is the kind of math that students across the nation are doing. This is a relatively small number of students in our district. More students are doing math six, seven, and then we have another group that are doing math seven, eight, and another group that are doing Algebra 1 in sixth grade. It's a little tiny group of kids up here. One of the things that happens in a community like Lake Forest is like, oh, whatever's on the top of the chart, that's where I want my kid to be. It's a very natural thing. And that's why we made this a through grade 12 chart. Because if you are aspiring to, for your student to be here, what this means is that in their sophomore year, they take pre-calc, and then they're taking Calc BC. That is a full year of theoretical college calculus. And in their senior year, they're taking multivariable calculus and other advanced topics, okay? There's a chunk of kids that we have there. Most of our kids will be down here, and this is where we want to see as many kids as possible, which is completing calculus or statistics by grade 12. One of the things, anybody that's aspiring to one of these things, the question you have to ask yourself is, what need do most human beings have for multivariable calculus? Okay? And it can look like a really desirable thing to advocate for, you know, I want my kid to be on top. I want my kid to be in math 6-7 in fifth grade. And in fifth grade, that might be a good place. But the thing that parents have to be thinking about for their students is the end of it. Is multivariable calculus a good place for my kid to be in high school? Because they have to take 4 years, and these 4 years count. These are the 4 years that are effectively your shots on goal for college. And if somewhere along the way this gets really hard and really, really stressful, and very frankly, our highest achieving kids are our most anxious kids, very, very frequently. They are super risk averse, and many of them are super anxious. So when we talk about support for kids, we're not just talking about the kids that have some sort of learning disability. We're talking about kids that have anxiety disabilities, and it's quite a good chunk of our student population, very frankly. So this sequence really, really matters, because what you don't want is to take a kid that loves math and put them in a math sequence where they're stressed out, freaked out, and now they don't love math anymore. And it can reach that point at any point along the way. So there's a certain level of math that I believe that our kids should have, and that is the overwhelming majority of our kids should wind up in a stats or a calc class, a large percentage of them. By the way, the ACT only tests through trigonometry. It doesn't test math beyond that. And it's complex advanced algebra and some complex trigonometry from time to time. But our students that are that don't reach calculus, they do trigonometry as 11th graders in the form of an advanced algebra, and they get some trig along with that. So we are going to be challenging kids no matter what. If you hear somebody say, we're not challenging students in the district, what I can tell you is we have 30 students right now that are eighth graders that go over to the high school in eighth grade for advanced algebra. So think about when you took advanced algebra, okay? Probably not many of us took it in eighth grade. So we've got that class. Next year, we'll offer that class at Deer Path itself. So it'll be a class in the school. And it's something we're always measuring. We want to challenge kids. We want to provide the most rigorous coursework that we can for them. But we're always very mindful of, it's one thing to be challenged. It's another thing to be really frustrated. A little bit of frustration is okay, but a lot, you start to look at shutdown. One of the struggles that we had with our high school, and some of you with older kids can empathize with this, is we had the attrition rate from some of our math classes was really significant at the high school. That's one of the things that we're working by providing supports. We're working to limit the number of students that wind up dropping back so that they're on a sequence where they can be successful, and they are. We provide support for them, and they march right along. So we're going to have as much rigor as the kids need, wherever that might be. Our math department chair at the high school is very committed to that. And with that, I'd like to end the superintendent's report. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. We now come to public participation. The Board of Education welcomes public attendance and participation at all of our meetings. If a member of the public would like to address the board, they should come to the microphone and please state their name and address before addressing the board. Are there any members of the public who would like to address the board at this time? Seeing none, we'll move on to reports and discussions. Our first report is the proposed 2016-17 and amended 2015-16 calendars. And I believe Barry Rogers will be leading that discussion.
So under consideration, we have first the 2015-16 amended calendar, and we come tonight to amend the calendar. One of the things that we pointed out as part of the collective bargaining process, and our best minds in terms of the association and administration came together and said it's really important for our teachers to have that extra professional development, professional learning, really putting a premium on professional learning. And so we have to add that day into the calendar, and so that's one piece. And in the board packets, and Mr. Simic showed an eye chart. This really is an eye chart. What I've done here is kind of moved on and just hit some of the highlights of the amended calendar. Again, you'll find the information in your packet. We have the additional professional development day, and that's going to be on March 18th, 2016. There's an emphasis on having full weeks of school. I know in the past there were concerns with weeks being broken up, concerns about continuity of the educational experience. We've addressed that and making sure that we have as many full weeks of school as possible. We're including a snow day option on Friday, February 12th, if needed. And that it has been omitted from the actual calendar, but we would like to include that. As you know, snow days can get tricky depending on where you get them. We've also added the additional 5 days in the calendar. So in both forms of the calendar that you have, you'll see the additional snow days at the end of the year. Also, I am sure that Mr. Simic has talked to the National Weather Forecast and the Farmers Almanac and making sure that we don't have any more snow days this year. So things are looking good, fingers crossed. Again, the additional 5 days are indicated at the end of the year, and we've done, I think, a pretty good job at aligning to a high degree with District 115. And for that matter, we also meet with Lake Bluff as well in terms of meeting with that. Part of the process, when we originally went through this, we also got a lot of feedback from our parents and from the association as well as the principals. In the board package, you'll also find the other calendar for 2016 and 2017. Again, as we're starting from scratch, we received input from our principals, APT and LFEA. It was, again, an emphasis on having full weeks of school. Our snow day option for this year will be Friday, February 17th, if needed. And there are additional 5 days added to the end of the calendar. And once again, it is aligned to a high degree with District 115. You'll also notice in the packet, it has the total school days. We have 174 school days and 2 report days. We also have the 5 institute days and the 5 days for emergency. Are there any questions?
I had a question about the conferences. It looks like the conference schedule for next year is changing from what we've typically seen. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Okay. In what way are you saying that is changing?
It looks like parent-teacher conferences moved up to October. They typically were the week of before Thanksgiving.
Yeah, I think, in terms of the date, in terms of the thinking on that, we're on a trimester system, and I think the thinking was with our educators to get a little bit ahead of the curve, if we could, working with our students. If we're going to have to bring in any interventions, for instance, it's best to always get an early start on that. Just in terms of practice, too, getting to know your teacher. I know we all go to curriculum night and so on and so forth, but just having that earlier contact, we think, will benefit our students.
Sorry, did you say that the February 17th would be a possible put back on the calendar for students' day?
So February 17th, yes, could be a possible, and that's for the 2016-17 calendar.
Okay, I just didn't see it noted anywhere on the paper that we got in our packet.
Yeah, it's actually.
I know we had talked about it, but I just wanted to.
Yeah, so for that one, we gave 3 different copies. I think it's noted on the one with the star, so we gave different versions of it, which is a little bit more readable. But I think next year we'll put it on all 3 of them, so our apologies on that.
One of the things we spent a lot of time last year talking about, and with Mr. Schuler in the audience, I'm going to go ahead and bring this up, was half days, and obviously wanting to minimize half days. I noticed that there are still the 2 half days on next year's calendar. Did we feel like we couldn't make those full days off or full days on?
I think that was the thinking. I think we made great strides in trying to make as many full days as possible, but there are a couple half days that we felt were warranted.
Those are known as Schuler days now.
I think, though, if you do compare, you know, the number of half days compared to what happened in the past, and I think comparing to other school districts, I think it is very, very much minimized. And I think it is a good thing.
Any other questions or comments for Barry from the board? Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next report is the fund balance report. And this time we have the pleasure of Alan. Excellent.
Yes, no PowerPoint though. A lot of this was touched on in the budget presentation, so I'll try and be very brief, but there are a couple of points that are worth reiterating. But just as background, the board has a policy 4.20 that states the district seeks to maintain a year-end aggregate fund balance in the range of 10% to 15% of annual expenditures. In the event that the fund balance falls below the 10% threshold, or in the event that the fund balance exceeds 15%, then a report is to be given to the board no later than the September board meeting. So at the moment, we are above the threshold. From the figure shown earlier, we're at almost a 23% threshold. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how we got there, and then the intent of the report is what's the plan for that. So in 2000, the district embarked on the last major facility renovation that was done in the district, and that was aptly named Project 2000. And the renovations that were made, and they were done to every school, there were additions and improvements made, really carried us through the early part of the century. As we got to about 2010, though, with the economy in the state it was in, as an administration, we held off on some capital improvement projects that we normally would have initiated because there would have been time, a decade in to the last major renovation. As we've stabilized and come through that, now it's time and we're going to be embarking on those, and I'll talk about those in a second. But the other reason that the fund balance grew during this time period is we've also had declining enrollment. In the last 5 years alone, we've had a decrease of about 350 students, so that reduces our staffing needs as well. The budget that was shown tonight had a deficit of our capital projects fund that was shown tonight had a budget of $1.7 million. That's a significant increase over what we spent last year. And as Ms. Hermes talked about, it's what we would anticipate spending over the next few years. So one of the big jobs that we do during the course of the year is make a lot of assumptions around expenses and revenues in the school district, whether it's enrollment, staffing, state revenues, interest earnings, facility needs, retirements, and we compile all those and we look at the trend and where that's taking us. So while we see that fund balance coming down over the next few years, mainly attributable to capital projects and life safety improvements, we don't see a structural deficit. And a structural deficit is really what the state of Illinois is experiencing right now. Just the course of normal day-to-day operations exceed the revenue that's coming in. We don't see that happening, but we do see a drawdown over the next few years because of the capital projects and life safety initiatives that we'll have. We don't want to be like some surrounding districts that ignore their facilities and fall into dire repair. So I think it's a good balance. We've built the fund balance up. We were conservative during tough economic times, and now we're reinvesting in our facilities. Any questions?
No questions? Thank you, Alan.
Hey, Mike, before we go on, can we get Barry back up there?
We do have one question for Barry.
So for the 2016-17 calendar, I'd just like you to talk a little bit about alignment with the high school. So it's one question is the last day of school, will that mm-hmm. align with the high school? And I think maybe more importantly is we're changing the week of Thanksgiving so that we're going to have two full days of school, Monday and Tuesday, because of moving up conferences. And I actually have no idea what the high school does that week, even though I have a high schooler. And so, I guess I'm concerned about is if the high school doesn't have school on that Tuesday, is the middle school really going to have a good day of school? So I'm just wondering the alignment of the high school piece.
Yeah, I think the first thing I would say about the high school alignment, you have to keep in mind that there are different contractual agreements between the two schools. So for instance, the high school has 176 school days, whereas District 67 has 174 school days. They have additional professional development days in District 67. We also have two different systems where we have a semester system and we have a trimester system. So again, we align them to whatever degree possible. You know, on that day, in terms of that Thanksgiving day, that's something I have to kind of double check again in terms of the high school not going on. You're saying on that Tuesday? Yeah, because that was something I was unaware of. Okay, so it does align then.
I think the discrepancy comes in November. If you look at the Friday, November 11th, where the 67 kids have a half day, they go a full day at the high school. They're off the week prior. They have 2 days off the week prior for conferences and professional development. So yes, so that is potentially a misalignment.
We're not ending on the exact same day, but again, to whatever, getting it as close as we can. The other thing too is the elementary school does prefer when they start the school year. They do prefer to start in the middle of the week. They find that it's easier on the younger kids than they have the first full week of school. You're welcome. Thank you.
Any other questions for Barry, Alan, or anyone else? Okay, we move to board committee reports now. Our first board committee report is the Board of Education, headed by Beth Clemenson.
Okay, the Education Committee met for its first meeting of the new school year on September 9th. The first item on the agenda was public comment, and I think it's worth noting that all Education Committee meetings are open to the public, and there is an opportunity for comment at these meetings at both the beginning and the end. So please feel free to join us next time. A member of the public did address the committee at this last meeting and talked about the importance of restoring penmanship in the curriculum. The parent advised that given the shift from cursive writing skills to keyboarding skills, in the elementary school, there is now high school students who may have challenges formulating their signature or reading and writing in cursive. And while she acknowledged the practicality of keyboarding in the digital age, she did urge the committee to consider the importance of writing and penmanship for ACT and AP exams, reading historical documents that are written in cursive, and signing one's name to legal documents. The committee acknowledged that this was a topic that surfaces from time to time, and it's obviously important to find the right balance for all students. From public comment, the committee welcomed its newest members to the committee, Dr. Tara Edgars and Mrs. Carolyn Moore. As previously announced, these ladies will be serving a two-year term as committee representatives on the Education Committee. We also began our work by taking a close look at the Education Committee charter. This charter was revised last year, but we felt it was an important to take a fresh look at the start of the school year to determine if it still reflected the mission of the group. Specifically, three purposes of the committee were outlined. One, provide a forum for vetting and discussing major educational initiatives. Two, provide representative board and community feedback, insight, and direction to the administration. And three, provide feedback, insight, and direction to the board as a whole regarding current and future educational initiatives. It is important to note that the committee does not take any action in committee, and that is reserved for the board as a whole. The charter was reaffirmed without revision. So fellow board members, you'll see it on the action items today, but we made no changes to the current charter. We discussed what has been going on this past summer, and considerable work has taken place. consistent with the vision outlined by the board and what we've discussed this evening. There is a commitment to professional development for our educators, and there was significant professional learning taking place all summer long. Ms. Milks estimated that nearly 2,000 hours of PD were completed across multiple disciplines, and most primarily around the new Lucy Calkins Writing Workshop. In addition, though, to the writing workshop, there was a Lucy Calkins Summer Institute attendance, a Number Sense boot camp, a Bridges conference, DPM math course planning around the new connected math curriculum that we voted on earlier this summer, and inspiration block planning, and Atlas curriculum writing across all curricular areas. We then moved into our 2015-2016 curriculum goals, particularly looking at the four core subjects. From language arts, not surprisingly, the two key goals are to implement the Lucy Calkins writing units of study for the current year, and also to initiate the planning and development for the Lucy Calkins reading program for next year. The committee discussed the excitement that the teachers are finding with the new curriculum, which is obviously very encouraging. In addition to the Lucy Calkins material, there's also work around using the Greek and Latin root word lists, and Ms. Milks has been working with the Latin teachers at the high school regarding the best roots to use at the K-8 level. In addition, grammar will be infused into this writing curriculum, and there's work to develop a set of grammar standards for all grades K-8. The committee discussed the idea of developing a district writing handbook that would outline all of these standards for parents, students, and the community, evidently something many districts do use. And completing this in concert with the high school was seen as particularly important by the committee, so that there is that seamless articulation similar to what we just saw on the math side. In the area of math, the two key goals are continued implementation and improvement of the K-5 Bridges program, as well as implementation of the 5-8 Connected Math curriculum. As we've seen tonight, the math teams have made a lot of progress in both the articulation and curriculum materials across all of the grades, and the team is working towards consistent utilization of the new materials and will surely and hopefully lead to demonstrated student growth in math. On the science front, the teams are completing alignment to the next generation science standards and identifying the materials necessary to accomplish this alignment and articulating the assessment tools needed. In social studies, they want to ensure K-4 alignment with the C-3 framework for state standards. And C-3 stands for college, career, and civic life. The standards are a guide across K-12 for civics, economics, geography, and history. And then on the 5-8 side, they're developing course sequencing using the understanding by design framework. And then lastly, we talked about multi-tiered system of supports, making sure that there is an MTSS coordinator at each campus, and developing systems to regularly review data at each of our campuses. Our next topic was the inspiration block. Obviously, the pilot program at Cherokee was expanded to all grades this year based on overall positive feedback on the program in kindergarten, third, and fourth grades last year. The committee discussed the opportunity for the program is really to identify and articulate very clear goals and success measures and determine how best to proceed beyond this two-year pilot. Mr. Rogers will be undertaking the task of taking a holistic review of the Inspiration Block program and making recommendations to the board on where that program should go next. Obviously, this will be something we'll be continuing to be in discussions on in the coming months. The last topic we covered was executive functioning, looking at the opportunity to provide more executive functioning coaching for our students in middle school. Whether this coaching is embedded into teacher training for use with students day to day, or something that might be more of a class, like a brainstormers class for students and parents, is still TBD. Some on our committee felt this training would be helpful as students first transition to middle school in fifth grade, or perhaps later in middle school as a preparation for high school. But more research and identification of resources is being done on this topic. That concludes the Education Committee report. Our next meeting will be Wednesday, November 18th at 8:15 a.m. here on West Campus, unless any of my colleagues have anything else to add.
Thank you, Beth. Any questions or comments related to the Education Committee report? Thank you. Our next report is from the Board Finance and Operations Committee, headed by Rob Lemke.
Thanks, Mike. Just so everyone knows, we have implemented this process of putting up reports online that everyone can access. So I am actually going to call on people to go and read that report, the full minutes, if they want all the little details, since a lot of them have been spoken to by other people tonight. So I'll give a brief report. So this is for August 6th. The Finance and Operations Committee met at 8 a.m. We began by welcoming two new community members, Chris Byers and Tara Janos, to the committee. We also then circulated a new committee charter, which includes the two new names, as well as we clarified that community members can serve up to 2 two-year terms, but that doing so requires reapplying for the position, a suggestion that Jeff made, and so that new charter will be in front of us later tonight. Jen and Alan talked about the budget. You saw much of that tonight. There was also some discussion about some policies, which are going to come out of the policy committee. We'll hear about them tonight as well, referring to P cards and to some contract issues. And so I'll let people talk about that later. The one thing that hasn't been mentioned that probably I should mention is that Jen discussed with the committee the district's contract for banking services that we currently have with Lake Forest Bank and Trust. And our current contract was originally a 3-year deal with 2 one-year extensions that the district enacted. And thus the current 5-year deal or 5-year relationship with Lake Forest Bank and Trust is set to expire this December. The district can either rebid its banking services or sign another 3-year contract with Lake Forest Bank and Trust, with a district option to renew for 2 years after that. Lake Forest Bank and Trust recently provided Jen with the specifications of such a contract, and Jen spoke very highly of the specifications, including an interest rate that exceeds what other North Shore districts are receiving, very low fees, a favorable fund balance requirement, and a willingness of Lake Forest Bank and Trust to accommodate our payroll requirements. For all of these reasons, the committee unanimously endorsed Jen, asking the board to approve a banking contract with Lake Forest Bank and Trust without rebidding it. Unless something changes, and I haven't heard that anything has, the board should expect to hear from Jen, I think, at the next meeting. I think 1:15 has to be clued in first. Given that we met on August 6th, the committee will next meet on September 22nd, tomorrow morning at 8 a.m., and we're going to primarily discuss the district fee policy, and hopefully people can appear if they want.
Questions or comments for Rob? For the public, Beth mentioned in her report, encouraged everyone to attend. All of our committees are open to the public. All of them are in compliance with the Open Meetings Act. They're all listed well in advance on the website, and you all are encouraged to attend all of our committees. With that, we move to the policy committee, headed by Jeff Folker.
And if anyone is suffering from insomnia, they can come to the policy committee meetings. The policy committee has met twice since our last board meeting. The first meeting was held on August 26th. This meeting was initially intended to be a joint policy committee meeting with District 115, but District 115 did not have a quorum number of members present. So it ended up taking place as District 67 only, which was fine. The purpose of this meeting was to review and revise two specific policies, which we will be discussing this evening. So I may steal Alan's thunder here, but I'll go ahead and talk a little bit about each one. First is policy 4.55, which deals with the use of credit and procurement cards by district staff. And the other was policy 4.60, which addresses overall purchases and contracts. Present at the first meeting were myself, Mrs. Sands, Mr. Novit, Mr. Alvis, and Mrs. Fowler. With regards to policy 4.55, this current policy only authorizes the superintendent or district employees designated by the superintendent to use district credit or procurement cards. However, there are definitely instances where a non-employee of the district, for example, a contractor, working on behalf of the district, needs to make purchases of equipment, materials, services, etc. As a result, Mr. Albus has recommended adding verbiage to the policy that authorizes agents of the district to use a credit and/or procurement card when designated by the superintendent. This change would allow designated district contractors to purchase necessary equipment, materials, etc. on the district's behalf. Mr. Albus also recommended an update to Section 6 of Policy 4.55 that would address a conundrum within this policy, where currently no member of the District 67 administration staff is authorized to approve purchases made by the superintendent. The insinuation within this policy is that the board is the only body that can approve purchases by the superintendent. But since such purchases need to be paid monthly and on an ongoing basis, and often prior to a board meeting, there is a need to add verbiage that addresses this loophole. The specific recommendation will be discussed later during the first reading of this revised policy. With regards to policy 4.60, the current policy specifies that all district contracts must be approved by the school board, no matter the size or scope. Mr. Albus recommended amending policy 4.60 so that only contracts worth $25,000 or more need to be brought before the board for approval. After some discussion regarding how many contracts would be affected by this change and the values of several important contracts that have historically been brought before the board, it was decided that Mr. Albus would look at contracts approved by the board over the last 12 months and provide the committee with some detail that would be presented at the next policy committee meeting. Mr. Albus also pointed out that policy 4.60 does not technically allow bills to be paid between the start of the fiscal year and the approval of the district budget, which, as we just found out, occurs in September. To close this loophole, Mr. Albus recommended adding verbiage that allows the district to expend up to a specified percentage of the prior year's budget during this gap. The specific recommendation will be discussed later during the first reading of policy 4.60. Our second meeting was on Friday, August 4th. The purpose of this meeting was to finalize recommendations from the August 26th meeting regarding the aforementioned two policies, address press issue 89, discuss the adoption of a new policy 4.175 dealing with convicted child sex offenders, criminal background checks or screens and notifications, to continue discussions regarding the board's role in approving curriculum, which came up back in our June and July meeting, and updating several policies to incorporate the district's new vision, mission, and core values. Present at this meeting were myself, Mrs. Sands, Mr. Novit, Mr. Simic, Dr. Wilcox, Mr. Albus, Mrs. Hermes, Mr. Rogers, Ms. Milk, and Mrs. Fowler. We had all had a great time. Mr. Albus presented his recommended changes to policies 4.5 and 4.60, and the committee agreed to present them tonight for a first reading. Mr. Albus and Mrs. Hermes also presented a proposed new policy, which addresses how the district should deal with convicted child sex offenders on school property, criminal background checks and screens on anyone with direct daily contact with students, and notification of parents about such issues. While new, this policy is essentially taking the section of current policy 1.70, which deals with convicted child sex offender and notification laws, and provides more depth and specificity. It also adds a new section about criminal background checks and screening. We will get into more detail during the first reading of this proposed policy later in the meeting. Next, the committee reviews press issues 89, our committee recommendations relative to accepting or rejecting the various suggested policy additions and edits will be presented later in the meeting. The committee then spent time reviewing and discussing policies 2.20, powers and duties of the board, and policy 6.40, curriculum development, with the intent of better clarifying the role of the board relative to approving curriculum. This is especially relevant in light of the discussion and questions surrounding the new connected math materials that were brought before the board back in June. The committee decided that policy 2.20 should remain unchanged and that any further clarification of the board's role should be embedded in policy 6.40. Mr. Rogers and Ms. Milk agreed to try and clarify the depth of the board's involvement in curriculum decisions and present their recommendations at an upcoming policy committee meeting. Lastly, the committee discussed proposed changes to policy 1.30, school district philosophy, and policy 6.10, educational philosophy and objectives. Both policies need to be updated to reflect the district's new mission, vision, and core values. Mrs. Sands agreed to rewrite these policies as well as others that may be affected and present recommendations at an upcoming policy committee meeting. Our next policy committee meeting is slated for next Tuesday, September 29th at 8 a.m. here in the West Campus. All are invited. Thank you.
Any questions for Jeff? See none, we move on to the Compensation Committee. Thank you, Jeff. We move on to the Compensation Committee headed by Tom Ford.
This will be brief, as the Compensation Committee did not meet, but the committee is still gathering information from other districts regarding the best practices on how to best conduct annual reviews of compensation for administration and staff. The next meeting has not yet been set, but will be likely next month, and when it, and if it's before the October board meeting, the time and date will be posted well in advance for you all to come and join in. Thank you.
Questions for Tom regarding Compensation Committee? Seeing none, we move on to the Joint Shared Services Committee, which I had. The JSSC met at 7 p.m. on August 31st. Reese Markison and John Powers from the District 115 board were present, as well as Beth Clemenson, Mike Semick, and I. We discussed three topics. First, we discussed the superintendent evaluation process. The District 67 board members shared with the District 115 folks that we are in the process of revamping and hopefully improving the process used for evaluating our superintendent. We invited the District 115 folks to join us in this process, and they agreed. This work will continue. The second topic discussed was the process for determining salary increases for our administrators. Again, the District 67 board is starting a review of that process, and we invited the District 115 folks to participate in that process improvement effort as well, which they appreciated and accepted our invitation. Lastly, we discussed philosophically how Joint Shared Services employees' compensation should generally be split between the districts. We agreed that generally it should be split evenly in most normal situations. We discussed the Whipple Consulting contract, which is currently not an exact 50-50 split. We agreed that both districts would share equally in the costs of that contract in future years, as well as agreeing to changing a few terms in the contract again in future years. That meeting adjourned at 7:45. Any questions regarding the JSSC report? Seeing none, we move on to our liaison reports. Our first liaison report is the North Shore Special Education District, which Suzanne takes care of for us.
So NSSED met last on August 26th, and a few things that were talked about. They have a new program called Arbor Academy that they are starting this year. It is designed to meet the complex needs of students with autism spectrum disorders and other related disabilities. It is a self-contained program for kids with a complex set of needs. They're opening it with an early childhood classroom, a K-2 classroom, and a 3-5 classroom. Each one will only start with three students this year, but has the capacity of up to eight. They are also, NSSED is in the process of a new superintendent search. The superintendent of NSSED retires at the end of this school year. And anyone who would like to provide input into what they should be looking for in a superintendent is welcome to do that. There's an online survey that can be filled out, and you can get to it by just going to nssed.org, and you'll see it right there on the homepage. Finally, District 109, one of the member districts in NSSED, has announced their intention to withdraw from NSSED. One of the steps required in that process is that all member districts have to vote on approving whether or not we believe that they have the programs and services necessary to provide appropriate services for their students within their district. So that is on our action items for this evening. Either way, they're withdrawing from NSSED. What the vote does is, if we vote to approve that and all the other member districts vote to approve it, they go through a consensual process of withdrawal, and if any district votes not to approve it, they go through a non-consensual process. I believe about a month ago I sent everyone information on what District 109 has done in order to be prepared to meet the needs of their students within their programs, and it is something that I recommend that we support and approve of this evening. The next NSSED meeting is Wednesday, October 14th.
Thank you, Suzanne. Any questions for Suzanne regarding NSSED? Seeing none, we'll move on to our legislative liaison, Beth Clemenson.
There's no formal report this month, as things are just starting to heat up on the legislative front, but board members should keep their eyes and ears open. You may recall during my report at the July board meeting, I talked about two pieces of legislation that were recently passed. At the federal level, in the Senate, the Every Child Achieve Act was passed, and in the House, the Student Success Act was passed. Both of these pieces of legislation are alternatives to No Child Left Behind. Congress now becomes the arduous task of reconciling these two pieces of legislation and finding something that also meets with the approval of the legislative branch, so certainly more to come on that front. At the state level, there are no bills currently moving forward, but we expect school funding policies and the property tax freeze, again, that we talked about in July, to resurface this fall in a big way. And so we will certainly be staying close to those two items as well. More to come.
Questions for Beth? Thank you, Beth. We now move on to the Spirit of 67 Foundation. Suzanne.
The Spirit of 67 Foundation Board held their first meeting of this school year on September 8th. This year, they're hosting two new fall events in place of the fall luncheon. One is Kick Up Your Boots for Education, a barn dance benefit, which will be held on Saturday, October 17th. Since everyone won't be able to make it to the barn dance, they are also inviting the entire community to Raise Your Hand for Education, which will be an online auction Tuesday, October 13th through 9 p.m. on Friday, October 16th. Information about both events will be provided in invitations going out this week and also on the Spirit website. The Spirit of 67 Foundation is celebrating 30 years of supporting our schools this year. The organization was founded as a way to replace traditional school fundraising that involved spending lots of time and energy selling stuff to families and friends for relatively small profits. The foundation has proven to be a very successful endeavor over the decades and hopes to continue the tradition by engaging even more families as donors and businesses as partners and sponsors. The Spirit is starting this year with over $69,000 in donations through the registration process and just over 450 donors, representing approximately 40% of district families. Both year-to-date donations and participation are higher than they have ever been at this point in the school year. The next meeting is Tuesday, October 13th.
Any questions for Suzanne regarding the Spirit of 67? Thank you, Suzanne. We move to Jeff Folker, our APT liaison.
The first District 67 APT Executive Board meeting of the 2015-16 school year was held on Wednesday, September 9th here in the boardroom at the West Campus. New Board President Julie Passanato welcomed the board and announced that this year's APT theme is cooperation, the process of working together towards the same end. Some of the key takeaways from the meeting and updates include the APT Exec Board's budget for the school year was approved. The individual building budgets will be finalized by October 1st. It was noted the benefits of the online registration process and how nice it was to actually have your funds available up front as opposed to waiting to get it throughout the school year. Speaking of registration, the membership committee reported that approximately 90% of District 67 families joined the APT during the online registration process. While this number is not drastically different than what we've seen in years past, the major benefit is the memberships are all up front, as opposed to people having to go out and beg, borrow, and steal for memberships throughout the course of the year and put things on bulletin boards and so forth. So a huge benefit by having the online registration. A more detailed analysis of the membership numbers will be available at the October meeting. This past August, each building held a unique event welcoming new families to District 67, and the new families committee should be recognized for the diligent work they put in to put together folders for each new family that contained abundance of information to help them get acquainted and acclimated to Lake Forest and their school. The directory folks were also busy over the summer preparing both the online and hard copy versions of the District 67 student directory. The online version is up and running and can be accessed either via the website www.myschoolanywhere.com or via a link in an email that was sent out to all APT members at the end of August. The hard copy directory will be distributed to members via their oldest child in mid-October. Do I have that right? The oldest child, right? Whichever child they register, okay. In terms of school supplies, there were 1,140 school pack boxes delivered and distributed in August. That is a 22% increase over the past year. That is a huge number. Thanks go out to all the school supplies coordinators in each building for all their hard work in getting the boxes into the classrooms for families during walkthroughs. Looking ahead in the next month, our first visiting author of the year will be in the elementary buildings on October 20th, 21st, and 22nd. It is Barb Rosenstock. Also, I wanted to make note of a grant that was provided to the APT by the Spirit of 67 to start a visiting scientist program, which will be similar to the visiting author program and consists of a science-focused assembly for grades K through 2 and science workshops for grades 3 and 4 in all buildings, all elementary buildings. These science events are coordinated with the science teachers to enhance the current science curriculum and are based on disciplinary core ideas and next-generation science standards. These events will take place during the week of January 11th. Lastly, I would just like to recognize all of the APT Board of Education liaisons that will be joining us here in our meetings throughout the year, some of whom are here tonight. From the APT Exec Board, Megan Medica and Leslie Gleason will be the representatives. From Cherokee, Des Witte and Stephanie Zimmerman. From Everett, Alan Sikon, I hope I'm pronouncing his name right, Sikon, and Kathy White Renato. From Sheridan, Whitney Keller and Holly Mattson. And from DPM, Terry Albus and Christine Goshgarian. And welcome to those folks who are in the audience this evening. The next APT Executive Board meeting is scheduled for Wednesday, October 14th. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. Questions for Jeff? Any liaison reports that I may have missed? Fantastic. We move on to action items. Two quick notes on action items. First, for community members here or watching these proceedings, our board uses a committee structure to discuss and vet many of the items that come up for a vote. Much of the roll up your sleeves work and discussions occur at these committee meetings. Additionally, board members receive and review the board packet information thoroughly prior to these Board of Ed meetings. So it is the discussions and votings which occur at these meetings are a final step in a thorough and robust deliberation process. Secondly, for the board members, I'm continuing to try to move us towards alignment with Robert's Rules of Order, and Rob Lemke is my coach on that, and he's continuing to coach me on the proper way to do action items, which we're trying to do. So as I read each action item, we'll be looking for a motion and a second. If it's coming out of a committee, typically someone from the committee might make the motion and the second, and then after the first and second motion, we then introduce and discuss it in more detail if we need to. Did I get that right, Rob? With that, we move to our first action item, adoption of the 2015-16 budget. Do we have a motion to adopt the 15-16 budget?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion or introduction we'd like to? I know we had a budget hearing earlier. We got a shake no from Jen. Is there any questions from board members on this item? Then let's move to a roll call vote, please, Madam Clerk.
Mrs. Clemenson?
Aye.
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Mr. Borkowski?
Aye.
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you. Action item B is the adoption of resolution approving the withdrawal of District 109 from the North Shore Special Education District. Can we have a motion to approve that, please?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion or introduction? Suzanne, you want to lead us on this?
No, I mean, if anyone has questions, I'm happy to answer them, but I included that in my report.
Brief comment. Does this really affect us at all? It's more elective by Deerfield School District. Does this have any negative impact on our school district?
Not of any significance, no. It means that there's one less district that's a member, but that means that there's one less district drawing resources. And my understanding from serving on NSSCD thus far is that a majority of their budget is revenues driven by services needed. So when you take away a bunch of services needed, then there's fewer expenses because they no longer need to draw on the services either.
Yeah, there's two parts. There's the question before the board is whether or not the board has the reason to believe that Deerfield 109 can provide services to the children that they are going to withdraw from NSSED. That's really the question that the board needs to address. Many of the districts are struggling with a different question, which is, should they permit a district to leave the co-op because there could be a financial repercussion for them because there are fewer hands to carry the load, so to speak. I think that, you know, the right thing to do is to allow them to withdraw because we have no reason to believe that that they can't meet the needs of the students, but it could be in the future that we discover that there are that NSSCD is experiencing some strain financially, in part because the district's leaving. That's my read on that, Jen. I don't know if you have anything that you wanted to add to that, or Alan. But that's my
can
read.
I, yeah, and what I'd like to add is the only piece of it that we're voting on right now is whether or not we think District 109 has the resources to provide for their students. And the reason for that is they can withdraw whether we give the approval or not. The only difference that happens for them, and they have stated that they are withdrawing regardless. So whether or not they get approval from all the other member districts, they are withdrawing. And it's a matter of, do they withdraw through this consensual route or the non-consensual route? And from the discussions that I've been involved with and listened to, there are technical differences in those two routes, but neither one of them addresses what happens to NSSCD. This district is withdrawing regardless.
Nothing to add. That was stated perfectly.
Any other questions or comments? We have a roll call vote, please, Madam Clerk.
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Mr. Borkowski?
Aye.
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mrs. Clemenson?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you. Next item is the approval of the 2016-17 calendar. Do we have a motion to approve that?
So moved.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Thank you. This was the topic that Barry shared with us earlier. Is there any discussion on this topic? Seeing none, could we have a roll call vote, please?
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Mrs. Clemenson?
Aye.
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Mr. Borkowski?
Aye.
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you. Next up is the approval of the 2015-16 amended calendar, also as presented by Barry Rogers earlier tonight. Do we have a motion to approve this?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Thank you. Roll call vote, please. Aye.
Sorry. Mrs. Clemenson?
Aye.
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Next up, approval of Finance and Operations Committee updated charter. Do we have a motion to approve that?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any introduction or discussion? Could we have a roll call vote, please?
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Mrs. Clemenson?
Aye.
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Mr. Borkowski?
Aye.
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Next is the approval of the Education Committee updated charter. May we have a motion for that, please?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Discussion on that, please? Seeing none, roll call vote.
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Mrs. Clemenson?
Aye.
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Mr. Borkowski?
Aye.
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Next is the approval of Exhibit A and Exhibit B of the superintendent contract. Could we have a motion to approve that, please?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
I'll kick off the introduction of this and any discussion, as much for the members of the public as anything. We are required by law to have written superintendent goals. Over the past few years, the eight of us, including the superintendent, agreed that we wanted more definitive superintendent goals that actually meant something, both in the evaluation process for public transparency, so people could see what's going on. So over the past 4 or 5 months, the group has worked pretty hard to accomplish that. Exhibit A is the legal document that gets attached to the superintendent contract. In our goals, we refer to an Exhibit B, which is largely the job duties as well. So that's what we're actually talking about here. Is there any questions or discussion regarding the superintendent goals as shown in Exhibit A and Exhibit B? Seeing none, could we have a roll call vote, please?
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Mrs. Clemenson?
Aye.
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Mr. Borkowski?
Aye.
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Congratulations, Mike. Approval of amended Executive Director of Student Services multi-year contract. Could we have a motion to approve that, please? Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion on this item? Seeing none, could we have a roll call vote, please?
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Mr. Borkowski?
Aye.
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Mrs. Clemenson?
Aye.
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Motion carries.
The approval of the administrator teacher salary and benefits report. Could we have a motion to approve that, please?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Alan, could you give us a 15-second introduction to this item?
Sure. The state has a prescribed form that every district in the state is required to fill out and submit. The objective is laudable. It's to get an apples-to-apples comparison. We get frustrated with it a little bit because it doesn't take into account things like our model of shared services. It doesn't include certified ancillary staff such as librarians, reading specialists, nurses, psychologists, and speech and language pathologists. So it has some value, but it has, in our view, some limited value, but it's a requirement of the state. We recommend approval.
Thank you. Any questions or comments?
So it should be pointed out that on this report, those administrative roles that are designated as District 67 will have the full value of their salary allocated to District 67, even though in reality, it's a shared cost with District 115. Okay.
Any other questions or comments? Roll call vote, please.
Mrs. Clemmensen?
Aye.
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Mr. Borkowski?
Aye.
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you. Next is approval of policy 4:175, operational services, press issue 85, first reading. Is there a motion to approve that?
So moved.
Is there a second? Any introduction and or discussion?
This was included in your packets. Hopefully you've had a chance to look it over. As I mentioned in my earlier report, this is a recommended new policy from IASB. Essentially, it takes part of policy 1.70, safety, our safety policy, and provides more depth and description regarding how a district is to react to convicted child sex offenders on property, criminal background checks and notification laws, screening and notification of such issues to the parents. Relative to any changes in verbiage, there is none. Relative to the first part, there has been some verbiage added relative to criminal background checks. Specifically, there's a requirement that the superintendent or designee shall perform criminal background checks and or screening required by state law for employees, student teachers, students doing field work or clinical experience other than student teaching, contractors, employees who have daily direct contact with one or more children, and resource persons and volunteers. He or she shall take appropriate action based on the result of any criminal background check and screen. We recommend continuing this language, although it does bring up a bit of a conundrum relative to how do we do background checks on volunteers. And we are discussing that through the potential introduction of technology at a future date that would allow us to more effectively be able to monitor volunteers who are coming on property without creating a huge backlog or in any way dissuading people from volunteering within the buildings. Kent or Suzanne, if you guys have anything you want to add in that regard?
Yeah, I would say the emphasis would be on screening as opposed to checks in terms of volunteers, and we would want to do it in as minimally invasive and convenient a way as possible, and that's what's being explored by the administration right now.
Alan, do you have anything to add? So we recommend keeping the wording as recommended by ISB.
Any other questions or comments? Great. Could we have a roll call vote, please, for this first reading?
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Mr. Borkowski?
Aye.
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Mrs. Clemmensen?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you.
Mike, can I make one more note? Since this does affect policy 1.70, theoretically at some point we will need to approve an amended 4.170 policy. Since some of the verbiage has been removed, we'll wait until such time as press brings that forward in a future recommended packet.
We look forward to that very much. Next is approval of policy 4.55, use of credit and procurement cards, first reading. Is there a motion to approve this?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Introduction and comments, Mr. Folker?
Yes, as I noted in my committee report, policy 4.55 deals with the use of credit and procurement cards by the superintendent, employees, designated by the superintendent. Mr. Albus, do you want to provide a little bit more detail around the change that's being requested?
Sure. I've been told I'm being a minimalist over here, so I will add a comment on this. item number 7 on this says that on a monthly basis, the board will be provided usage reports. You already get those, but in our discussions, we invited Lisa Gillespian, who's a staff member who works with this, and one of the things she pointed out, or that she has access to, is a procurement card usage report by individual. So in your packet tonight, in your financial statements, and you'll see that going forward, will be an additional report that just shows the usage by individual by month. It's for some reason it's much easier to read when it's broken up that way, so that'll be included. And on an annual basis in September, the board will be provided a list of individual cardholders and their current credit limits. That's really a snapshot once a year, because this isn't static during the year. Credit limits go up and down and individuals can change, but to give sort of an overview of what the program looks like and who has cards.
Thank you. Questions or comments? Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Borkowski?
Aye.
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mrs. Clemmonson?
Aye.
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you. Next is approval of policy 4.60, purchases and contracts, first reading. Is there a motion to approve this?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Thank you. Introduction and comments?
As mentioned in my earlier comments, 4.60 deals with purchases and contracts. The fact that currently policy states that the board is to approve all purchases and contracts. There's a recommendation to amend that so that only contracts in excess of $25,000 need to be approved by the board. Mr. Albus, do you want to provide some additional detail behind that?
Sure. The other one is that as a press policy, I believe that unless a district is adopting their budget prior to July 1, there are districts all over the state that are in non-compliance with this. So we're trying to change the wording to really reflect what the normal practice is. As Mr. Folker pointed out earlier, between July 1 and the adoption of the budget, if you read the policies that currently exist, we have no authority to pay the electric bill. So this would allow us to do that. We set a parameter of 25% of the budget, of the prior year budget, that we can spend. I think it's important to point out this doesn't increase the amount of money anybody gets to spend. The controlling instrument here always has been, always will be, is the budget. It just authorizes us to initiate the funds in preparation for the upcoming school year to be ready.
Very good. Thank you. Any questions or comments? Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Mrs. Clemmonson?
Aye.
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mr. Borkowski?
Aye.
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you. Next is approval of press issue 89, first reading. Do we have a motion to approve that? Second?
Second.
Introduction and comments and discussion? Seeing none, could we have a roll call vote, please?
Mr. Forkett, you took me by surprise.
Do you want me to go through the reading of this? How do you want to do this? Because there's a lot.
It's up to you.
It's up to me?
It's up to you.
We've sent them out twice.
I want to get some direction here, because I want to make sure that we are effectively transparent in the policies that we are adopting, but I don't want to waste people's valuable time with a lot of policies that the only changes are legal definitions and descriptions.
Can you give us a quick overview of the ones that are actually changing?
Are there any that are substantive changes in this one, Jeff? Can I just give so just so that people understand this process, we get information that tells us what legal changes have happened and where we need to make adjustments to our policies to be in compliance with the law, to make sure that the letter of the policy reflects the law. And so sometimes he's not going to read through all the little ones that are about, we just need to change this wording or we just need to change this phrase to become in compliance with the new school code or new laws that have been enacted. And he's going to talk about the ones that actually substantively change policy as opposed to changing wording to be in compliance with the law.
Correct. Press is a service that we subscribe to as a district that sends, is provided by ISB, that in Illinois Association of School Boards, to allow us, instead of us having to do all of our own legwork and investigation relative to any changes in state laws or school codes and how they affect our policy, they do that on our behalf. We subscribe to that service, and they will send us from time to time large chunks of recommendations, changes to policies that we have in existence that may be needed to be changed to reflect any changes in law. So it can be a bit dry. So we want to make sure we're not wasting time, but at the same time, we want to make sure the public understands what changes are coming about. In policy 2.260, which deals with uniform grievance procedure, essentially the text is being clarified throughout the policy to reflect the rights of a complainant, an accused, and the school district when investigations pursuant to this policy occur. So there's no substantive changes to the language. It's merely meant as a point of clarification. This is reflective of, in response to an uptick in investigations by the Department of Education's Office for Civil Rights in Illinois involving Title VII, which is discrimination on the basis of race, color, and national origin, and Title IX, which is discrimination on the basis of sex cases. While the changes reflect what the Office of Civil Rights has requested in past investigations, investigations are a moving target. So there's no guarantee that this will not need to be changed again in the future, but this is merely a clarification of current policy. One thing that does change is there is the addition of the statement, a preponderance of evidence, when talking about how decisions are made and how appeals will be decided. Beyond that, there's no substantial change in the policy. In policy 5.50, the only change in this particular policy was the inclusion of verbiage that talked about being under the influence of an alcoholic beverage while being present on district premises or performing work for the district. Prior to that, there was some vagueness relative to what you could or could not dismiss someone or find someone in violation of the policy if they weren't theoretically, technically drinking or had an open container on property. This allows you to take advantage of the fact that someone may have consumed alcohol or drugs prior to coming on campus and be under the influence while doing work. Policy 5.17, we chose not to make any changes to the existing policy, but we haven't reached our 5-year period of review, so essentially it's in the packet for approval just so that we can change the date and become current on that particular policy, but there are no changes recommended. Policy 5.270, employment at will, only changes are some legal references. There have been some cases that are referenced in the policy that have been overturned. And the same goes with policy 5.290. It's only changes in the legal references. For policy 6.140, education of homeless children, again, this is just a need to make sure that we're reviewing it within our 5-year period. No substantive changes to the policy. For policy 7.10, equal educational opportunities, there has been an addition of protected classification that includes immigration status, and so that has been added to this particular policy to reflect that change in protected classification, or the addition of that protected classification. In policy 7.40, dealing with non-public school students, including parochial and homeschooled students, this deals with students with a disability. Just basically, the paragraph restates state law and federal law requiring districts to develop and implement a system to locate, identify, and evaluate children with disabilities who attend private schools, including religiously affiliated schools and home schools located within their district. Moreover, a district must conduct child find activities for private school children with disabilities that are similar to those children with disabilities in the public schools. So it's an addition of that requirement. Policy 7.260, dealing with exemption from physical activity. This is being updated to basically clarify a practice that I believe we're already doing, which is that Any student requiring adapted physical education must receive that service in accordance with his or her individualized educational program. So in other words, it's requiring that if a child has certain needs that limits their ability in physical activity, that we need to provide them with the appropriate service in accordance with the plan that's developed. Policy 7.310 just updates the policy to reflect changes in technology and the fact that publications can now be found on multiple types of devices. Policy 7.325, we chose not to do anything with student fundraising. Policy 8.80, dealing with gifts to the district. The policy is rewritten to clarify that it's gifts to the district. No major changes in this one either. Just said the board may remove or amend in any way the value of a gift that the superintendent or designee is permitted to accept. Otherwise, there's no substantive change to the policy. Those are all of the policies included in the press release.
Thank you. Questions or comment on any of these? Seeing none, could we have a roll call vote, please?
Mr. Borkowski?
Aye.
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Mrs. Clemenson?
Aye.
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you. Do we have a motion to approve the human resources items, including hiring, recertified, rehires, resignations, retirement, leave of absence, and change of assignment?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Could we have a roll call vote, please?
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mrs. Clemenson?
Aye.
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Mr. Borkowski?
Aye.
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you. We now move to the consent agenda. Any item on the consent agenda may be removed from the consent agenda at the request of a board member. Currently, the consent agenda includes approval of disbursement payrolls and financial statements dated July and August 2015, adoption of First Midwest Bank resolution, approval of long-term disability insurance contract, approval of recognition of school application, adoption of IMRF dissolution resolution, minutes of a regular meeting, July 21st, 2015, minutes of an executive session, July 21st, 2015, minutes of a board workshop, July 21st, 2015, minutes of an executive session, September 2nd, 2015, minutes of a special meeting, September 2nd, 2015, and disposal of audio recordings, January 30th, 2014, February 25th, 2014. Are there any items on the consent agenda that a board member would like to be removed for separate discussion?
Please remove item E, adoption of IMRF dissolution resolution.
Very good. We'll remove item E, adoption of IMRF dissolution resolution, from the consent agenda. I'm going to go ahead and look for a motion and second to deal with the consent agenda, and then we'll come back and talk about item E momentarily. Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda as read, excluding item E?
So moved.
Is there a second? Any discussion on the consent agenda? Could we have a roll call vote on the consent agenda, excluding item E, please?
Mrs. Clemenson?
Aye.
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Mr. Borkowski?
Aye.
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you. We now move to the adoption of the IMRF dissolution resolution. Is there a motion to approve this adoption?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion and introduction. Maybe Alan, you could start us off, or Jen, with a brief introduction of what this item is about.
Okay, I'm going to recap mainly the cover memo that went with it. District 67 is a charter school district organized under the city of Lake Forest. That's a very unique structure in the way schools are organized in Illinois. And what that really means under IMRF is that we're one employer, and we're really considered a branch of the city. That structure is operationally and philosophically problematic, and that was highlighted last spring when, through different audits, it was identified that the way we treat employee earnings and the way the city treated them were different. Both of them were okay, they were each acceptable, but IMRF required that they be consistent in one. So we were told that we had to conform to the city's way of treating the earnings. The problem with that is it very likely would have led to a grievance because it would have violated contracts. So there were some telephone calls, and after numerous calls in the intervention from the IMRF executive director, we got a resolution there where we could keep operating as we had historically done. But during those discussions, IMRF also identified for us that they would be willing to do an actuarial audit to separate the entities for a cost of $3,500. So we went ahead with that. And then depending on the results of that audit, then each entity could be a standalone entity. The actuarial report was received. What that says is that by separating, our actual employer rate will drop about 0.9%. Not a lot of money, it's about $3,000 a year. That's not the main motivator here. What will also impact us is financial or public entities have to report unfunded pension liabilities on their financial statements. Combined with the city and the library, that amount for us shows up as $12.7 million. By making this change, that will drop down to $1.7 million. So that's pretty significant on the financial statements. But the real reason for us is as we move forward, it allows us to make decisions good for the school district, independent of the city, and for the city to do the same, independent of the school district. So we recommend approval of this is presented.
Thank you. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, could we have a roll call vote, please?
Mr. Folker?
Aye.
Mr. Borkowski?
Aye.
Dr. Lemke?
Aye.
Mrs. Sands?
Aye.
Mrs. Clemenson?
Aye.
Mr. Novit?
Aye.
Mr. Ford?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you. We move to FOIA requests. We have no FOIA requests to report this month. Announcements, Thursday, September 24th, DPM West Curriculum Night. Monday, October 12th, Columbus Day, no school. Saturday, October 17th, Spirit of 67 Barn Dance. Tuesday, October 27th, our next Board of Education meeting, 7 p.m. right here. We now move to adjournment. Is there a motion to adjourn this meeting?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor of adjourning, say aye.
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 Any opposed? Thank you. We are adjourned. Thank you all for coming.